So it's a great pleasure to have Professor Basudev Dasgupta from Department of Theoretical Physics, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Mumbai, where I was there for 3 years and I did my postdoc, first postdoc there. He was there at that time. Basu is basically mostly working on astroparticle physics area. His expertise area is neutrino and dark matter. Apart from that, he works on many, many aspects. Those who don't know Basu, I just want to say a few words about his academics. He did his PhD from TIFR itself. He was a postdoc at Max Planck Munich, Ohio State University, and also very prestigious institute, which is ICTP. And then he joined as a faculty member at DDPT TIFR at 2014, I think. Am I right?
Yeah. December.
And yeah, and he's continuing there as a faculty. And Basu, and like, we are very happy to have you in the QASTM family. And this is basically the 56th talk in this series. And we hope we will learn a lot of things regarding supernova neutrino, because Basu is talking about supernova neutrino and the unrevealing of flavor coherence. So please, you can start.
Okay, excellent. Thanks, Hunter. It's a pleasure to be speaking to this audience. I imagine there are a lot of people here, who have been listening to these large number of this one. And so let me give you some background, sort of to set apart exactly what I'm going to do. So it's a 2.5 hour thing that we want to have. Of course, I don't want to speak for 2.5 hours continuously. I have planned for about an hour of actual material. And then I want to have like maybe a discussion for about another hour, but these two should not be separate. I would much rather that you ask questions in the middle and then we'll go slowly. The other point I want to make before I start is this is a talk about supernova neutrinos per se, which is somewhat of a niche topic. It's about neutrino oscillations happening inside stars. And we will argue why that is an interesting problem in itself. But also, this is a talk about something a bit more conceptual and general, which is, how does one get irreversibility out of reversible equations? Now, this is a very, very big, very old, very important problem. Boltzmann struggled with this problem. You start with mechanics. How do you get entropy? We will see that this problem has a touch of that magic sauce. And we will derive irreversibility out of reversible equations. Of course, for that, you need to do something magical. And we will have to do that. So these are the two parallel tracks, if you will, in this presentation or this talk that I'm going to give you. That on one hand, it is a talk about a specific topic, supernova neutrinos, but it is also a talk about something a bit more general and a conceptual point, which is underlying the specific example. Okay, so feel free to ask me questions about both of these aspects. Okay, so we will start. Okay. So I like to give my talks in a way where I give you the most important thing in my first slide. Okay, so this is the most important thing. So the most important thing that I am going to tell you about is that a variety of physical systems exhibit collective behavior. Collective behavior meaning that that a large number of agents, could be particles, could be atoms, could be birds, could be whatever, they act together in some sense. We don't have to define these very precisely yet. We will do that later. So one example is that, if you've seen these flocks of birds, this is very nicely visible. If you have ever been to Rome, just near the Rome train station, you see these birds that are, flying together, in these clouds. It almost feels like real life demonstration of kinetic theory of gases. So they flow like a big animal. It's almost as if this big cloud of birds or big gas of birds is a large animal on its own. Similarly, you've seen probably videos of fish under sea which do this. Neurons in our brain, they also can become very coordinated. You know, they all fire up and down together. And many, many such systems. So this happens across scales, across, you know, biology, chemistry, physics, everything. And this depends on, roughly speaking, two things: the number density of agents and what interactions do they have. So it turns out that for neutrino oscillations inside a star, this sort of collective behavior happens. You know, so there is no external agent that is telling all of these, you know, independently acting agents to coordinate themselves. You know, there is no drill master who's saying that, okay, everyone should march at left, right, left. There's no such thing happening. And yet, these independently acting agents, they manage to coordinate themselves. This is already a big surprise, right? So for example, human beings find it very difficult to coordinate themselves. You know, if I say this COVID crisis, for example, we found it very difficult just to convince everybody to wear a mask. You know, so just to make everybody do the same thing at the same time, it's very hard. I mean, just try, you know, having a meeting at 5 o'clock in the evening at some point. Unless everybody in that group is German, I can guarantee you that not everybody will be on time. So these are things that we know, that coordination of large number of things is hard. And so it's already a little bit interesting that some natural physical systems do that automatically. Fine. So that's one interest.
Basu, just what clarification I have. One.
Yeah.
So yes. Large number of systems, once they behave collectively, they follow certain kind of rules in physics?
Yes, I mean, so right now all I'm saying is that imagine you have one particle which has some trajectory and you have n number of particles, n is very large, let's say 10 to the 23, mm-hmm. and they have some, all the 10 to the 23 particles have some trajectory. If these trajectories are very correlated, you would say that this is collective. Okay, so I have not even talked about what are the underlying laws that lead to such things. Right now, this is all completely at an empirical observational level. And you see that this happens in real life, right? So in the case of neurons, we don't know what the underlying laws are probably.
Yes.
Or at least we don't understand them as well as, you know, there's a simple example I could give. Now, this is the oldest known example of collective effects, which is that pendulum, you know, two pendula, if you keep on, let's say, one table, they will tend to coordinate with each other. So for example, this is what Hertz had observed many, many, you know, decades ago, almost maybe a century ago, where he had two grandfather clocks and they were, you know, both kept in the same room with a wooden floor. Okay. And they had pendulum and there is no reason why both of them should oscillate in phase, right? I mean, it could be that they have the same time period, but they oscillate, you know, in some random phase. That's possible, right? And that's what should happen. But he observed that even if he started the clocks, you know, slightly out of phase, over time, the clocks became in phase. You know, they would always oscillate like this. And they're totally disconnected from each other, except for, of course, the fact that they're kept on the same, you know, floor. Now, you can actually see, there are lots of videos on YouTube where you can actually see that this happens, that you have two metronomes, you know, these are oscillating things which oscillate at a very fixed frequency. You keep it on a, you know, wooden board and they tend to synchronize. In this case, we understand the physics very, very well. It's just classical mechanics. But in there, so in this case, we know the laws, but there are many examples where we do not know the laws.
Mm-hmm.
And yet there is this collective behavior.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so that is one very interesting feature of many physical systems, that there is collective behavior. There is a second very important piece of physics that I'm going to now tell you about. This is not as common. And this is that the behavior of the collective system usually is the average of the behaviors of all the systems, all the agents. For example, if you think in terms of pendulum, what happens is that if you have lots of pendula, they oscillate with the average frequency. If you slightly change their lengths, you know, and if you make them oscillate collectively, what happens is that they oscillate with the normal mode. You know, and the first normal mode, the lowest normal mode, is just the average frequency of all the oscillators. This is something that we learn in our first year classical mechanics course. I will tell you about some very interesting new kind of phenomena where the speed at which the frequency at which the system evolves scales linearly with the number of agents. Meaning that if you have 10 oscillators of frequency omega, collectively they will oscillate with something like 10 times omega. If you put in 100 oscillators, they will oscillate at 100 times omega. This is very remarkable, right? Because if you think in terms of humans, not only do we fail to coordinate, if by adding more humans, the rate at which we can coordinate things becomes faster, that would lead to much more efficient activity by human beings. But that does not happen. Neutrinos, on the other hand, there are situations where such fast collective behavior is possible. The frequency of the collective behavior scales linearly with system size. This is what I will call fast. And I will give you an example when that happens. And then I will show you what this leads to. This leads to a certain kind of decoherence in the system. And that's the loss of, let's say, reversibility that I will talk about. Okay, so that is what this talk is about. And the specific example that I'm going to talk about is the supernova neutrinos, where this happens. So any questions at this point?
Guys, if you have any question, please ask. Otherwise, he will proceed.
Okay, good. I think there are no questions so far. It's fairly straightforward. Okay, so let's write a few equations. You see, I hope everyone here is familiar with neutrino oscillations. These are just two-level systems in quantum mechanics that we've learned. So what I am showing here, this first equation here, so I del t of some state is the Hamiltonian operator, you know, acting on that state. And this state nu, you can think of it as a two-component vector. There are two states. And H is a 2x2 matrix, which acts on it. And this is standard familiar two-level quantum mechanics that we do. And you will find that if this H is not a diagonal matrix, then the probability of finding the neutrino in, let's say, one of the states, let's call it nu e, if it started as a nu e at time, you know, t equals to zero, is this, and this is, it oscillates with time. This we are all familiar with. This is the same thing as a precession of a spin. Now, if you have a spin in a magnetic field and you ask what is the projection of the spin on the z-axis as a function of time, it is a sinusoidal behavior if the initial, you know, spin is not an eigenstate of the sigma z poly matrix. Okay, so if it is a linear combination of sigma x and sigma y, then over time, the probability oscillates. This is two-level oscillations that we are very familiar with. Now, this is something that we know in vacuum. So this is a system that's just kept in vacuum. You know, it does what it does. Once you put this two-level system in a medium, you know, in some bath. So by bath, I don't necessarily mean things where collisions happen, and I will be a bit more precise about this in one or two slides. But we have interactions, but not necessarily collisions, and distinction needs to be made. I think there is maybe a chat. All right. So there is some time-dependent sinusoidal behavior of the probability that you find the system in a given quantum state. And this probability is affected by the media. Okay. And one of the main things that affects this probability in the case of neutrinos inside a supernova is the fact that neutrinos can interact with other particles in the medium, let's say electrons and other neutrinos. And if they interact in a way that their momentum changes, then it's very obvious that the coherence of the state is lost. That initially you were in some state with momentum p, and later on you were in some other state with momentum p prime. And there is no sense in which I can talk about these two states as a linear superposition. So there is no interference. So we do not have to worry about such things. And that does not lead to two-level oscillations. But there can be a situation where this interaction happens and it leads to no momentum change. So you remain in the same quantum state except for the change of flavor. You know, whether in the upper level or the lower level of the two-level system, that can change. You know, so this linear combination of the two states, so in some sense, you're allowed to rotate in some internal Hilbert space. You don't change the momentum or the spatial location. Okay. Question is that at what frequency are you going to let this internal dynamics take place? And when that becomes proportional to n, that is fast. So what I'm showing here in the second equation is that I del t involves all the other terms. This is the old Hamiltonian, but it involves some new terms that look like this. What is this? This is nothing but the density matrix of the jth neutrino, okay, which is acting as a Hamiltonian for the ith neutrino, and you sum j from 1 to n, which is all the states within your box. Okay, so is this clear? Because this is kind of the main starting point, and I will show you this equation more in more detail later. But the conceptual point is that the Hamiltonian of each two-level system contains now a new term, this one, which is the sum over the density matrices of all the other neutrinos.
So this is basically appearing due to the interaction.
This is appearing because of forward scattering that I will tell you about. And this factor, 1 minus pi dot pj, this comes because this is the product of the four momenta of the two particles. So this is nothing. Yeah. So for ultra-relativistic neutrinos, both of them have, you know, same energy, you know, and therefore the E and P are basically the same. And this is nothing but 1 minus cosine of the angle between them. So this is just P mu J P mu I. I and J are particle indices, mu are Lorentz indices, and this quantity, which I'm just putting in braces, is nothing but the dot product, the Lorentz dot product of the two momenta of the ith and the jth. That's a coupling factor. There are, of course, factors involved in Fermi constant, which I will show later. Okay, so the outline of the talk is that I will tell you a little bit about theory of supernova neutron oscillations. Then I will show you this result for flavor depolarization or the unraveling flavor coherence. And then there are a whole bunch of things involving phenomenological significance and lots of remarks. We'll get to them if we get to them. Okay, so first of all, supernovae are very interesting. You know, they are more intense sources of neutrinos even than anything else that you can think of. Optically, they are brighter than, you know, a hydrogen bomb pressed against your eyeball. So don't try this at home. And they are very important because they make heavy elements. You know, they're the only place where certain elements are made, like carbon, oxygen, gold. Maybe neutron stars are now also known to make gold, but carbon, oxygen, up to calcium, I think supernovae are the only places. And they're very interesting. There's a lot of very interesting physics that has been done with supernovae. I think Chandrasekhar, you could say that his Nobel Prize is clearly because supernova explosion making neutron stars. Hulse and Taylor pulsar made out of supernovae. Koshiba discovered neutrinos from supernovae. And then there's type 1a supernova, thermonuclear supernovae. These are supernovae that do not emit neutrinos, but they're used for measuring the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. So very, supernovae are very interesting things. On the other hand, neutrinos are also very cool, you know, both literally and figuratively. So neutrinos, even if there are lots of them, they're very weakly interacting and they do not deposit any heat into any medium. For example, you know, if you're trying to fry an egg, you can just barely do that on the hottest day on the footpath, maybe not in Berlin or even in India, but if you went to something like, say, a desert, very area like something like Arizona, and you put a frying pan on the, you're just about close to frying an egg. But on the other hand, if you put a frying pan on the surface of the sun and say that I don't want to fry it using electromagnetic radiation, but only the neutrinos coming out, which deposit heat, and you wouldn't be able to do it. Okay, so neutrinos are, you know, really that weakly interacting. So when we talk about supernova neutrinos, this is really like, you know, like infinity times zero. So it's a very funny story where there is something like neutrinos, which is very, 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 very weakly interacting. And then there's a supernova which just produces a boatload of them. So then there is this competition that because there are so many neutrinos, even the very few number of them that do interact, they have interesting consequences. So that's why this is an interesting problem. So let me tell you a little bit about supernovae. So supernovae are formed from collapse of massive stars. There are two kinds of them, roughly speaking. So
you just said that since supernova produces a huge number of neutrinos, and thus we can actually consider some interaction due to neutrinos with the other matter. But like, is it that the interaction of neutrinos actually depends on the number density of the neutrino itself?
Yeah, so if we can say the following, and let's say, suppose we ask how many interactions will happen, right? So how many neutrinos, that goes as some cross section, let's say some typical cross section, you know, which in this case I'm actually writing as rate. Now this has units of one over time. And these are the number of interactions per unit time. But the actual number of interactions that I will see is this multiplied by the number density, right? So that's basically the rate that you're supposed to see. On number density of neutrinos, if it increases, then your overall rate increases, right? Sigma V, sigma is cross section, has units of length squared. V is velocity, it has units of length over time. Number density has units of 1/length³. So you can see that this has units of 1/time. So n sigma v is the rate at which events are being accumulated, at which you have signal events, at which you have interactions. So when n goes up for a given sigma v, your event rate goes up. Is that good?
Yes.
Good. All right. So we were talking about classification of supernovae. So there are two kinds of supernovae. One that comes, that happens because of collapse of a core of a massive star, so 8 to 10 solar mass star. And there are others that happen because of thermonuclear explosion. You know, basically it's like a hydrogen bomb that goes. So fusion, you know, happening in the center of the star produces so much energy that it just blows up the star. That's a type 1 supernova. We are going to talk about type 2 supernova, roughly speaking. These are core collapse supernovae, which happen because of a massive star which just runs out of fuel and then just its core collapses, and as it collapses it becomes very dense. Eventually it cannot collapse anymore, so it just bounces back, just like a rubber ball. If you squeeze it too much, eventually it will bounce back. And then once it bounces back, there is a shock wave that goes outwards in the star. As it is going out, it can just blow up the star. Okay, so that's the way core collapse supernova. Let me skip all this. Type 1 supernova are interesting because you can, you know, use them as standard candles. Core collapse supernova, I just told you a little bit about it. So let me skip all this. There are many of them that have been observed. we can talk about this a lot. But okay, so because you know, this is real physics, we also have to ask how often do these core collapse supernovae happen. So the answer is somewhere between 1 and 3 times in our Milky Way in a century. So once every 30 years, once every 100 years, let's say. That's the typical expectation. We haven't had one in the last 300 years. So, but that's Poisson statistics. So once the statistics is, once the rate is sufficiently small, you can have very long periods where you will not have any supernovae. The other point is that not all the supernovae would be visible optically, because some of them will happen behind the center of the Milky Way. As a result, the dust in the center of the Milky Way will obscure the supernovae. So only neutrinos can be sensitive to these supernovae, because neutrinos are not obscured by dust, and we will see them. But we have only had neutrino detectors for the last 30, 40 years or so. So we don't really know what the supernova rate in the Milky Way is. So there are good estimates, but still the error bars are large. Once we expand our search for supernovae a little bit outside the galaxy, so now I'm showing up to 10 megaparsecs. 10 megaparsecs is roughly the distance, the next few galaxy clusters. Then you start seeing several supernovae per decade per megaparsec. No, let's say 2 per decade per megaparsec in distance. That's a fairly large number. And if you really start looking at it cosmologically, there's a 1, 2, 3 supernova for every 100 years, for every century. For any volume that contains about 10 to the 10 solar luminosities. Okay, so that's the expected supernova. It's a fairly large rate. It's a significantly large rate that the shapes of galaxies are affected by supernova explosions. Okay, so supernovae are fairly frequently occurring things. It also depends on the kind of galaxy, whether there are more metals or not. More metals means more supernovae. So when you're looking for supernova neutrinos, we're going to try to detect them eventually. Your strategy must be correctly tuned to whether you're looking for very close by supernovae within, let's say, 10 kiloparsecs, which is the size of the galaxy, in which case you will see lots of neutrinos, you will see lots of neutrinos in one burst. You should see about 10 to the 4 neutrinos in largest experiments existing on Earth within 10 seconds of the supernova. But it only happens once in a century. Whereas you'll see about order 1 events if you're looking at something happening in Andromeda, but the rate is about once a year. And if you're willing to look cosmologically up to a redshift of, let's say, 2, then each supernova contributes much less than 1 neutrino at your detector. But your 4 pi r squared dr integral gives you a huge volume, and the rate of neutrinos coming to you becomes 10 to the 8 per year. So whether it depends on what you're trying to look at. So with this third category, this diffuse supernova neutrino background, you will not be able to pinpoint that, okay, here is a supernova and there is a neutrino that came. It's just some sort of a statistical detection of the bath of neutrinos being created by all supernovae. Whereas the first one is more of a event detection. So I think in gravitational wave physics also there are this same sort of distinction exists. LIGO has been detecting these single events, the large big events here and there. But there are other experiments, something like, let's say, a nanograv, which would be sensitive to some sort of a stochastic background of gravitational waves from all sorts of things. So the same kind of physics goes on. So one interesting thing is that there's this big star called Perihelios, and we're waiting for it to become a supernova. So this is going to be a spectacular event when it happens. You will be, of course, be able to see it with your naked eyes, and it will be visible during the daytime for about 2 to 3 months during the peak of its explosion. So this is, and we will, if it ever becomes a supernova, it will emit so many neutrinos that our neutrino detectors will get blinded. You know, we don't know how we will take all that data. So this is both interesting and a bit scary. I mean, that's what people live with. So most of the supernova in the galaxy happen roughly at a distance of about 10 kiloparsecs. What is being shown here on the x-axis is the distance from the center of the galaxy. Different lines are different models of the galaxy density. And then the galaxy density, roughly speaking, determines what is the probability that you will have a supernova at that distance. Initially, it rises because R squared dr rises like this. And then eventually later the density falls, and so the probability also falls. So the density peaks at about 10. Okay. So let me not go into too much of detail of supernova explosion mechanism. Let me skip over this. We can come over this if there are questions later on. Let me get more directly to the point that I want to make. Main points that I have here is to estimate that the typical energy of neutrinos coming from a supernova are around 10 MeV. Now that's the typical energy. On the other hand, neutrino mass is very, very small, less than electron volt. So you can treat neutrinos as ultra-relativistic. That's the main point. And one can estimate that the typical time scale over which the supernova emits neutrinos is about 10 seconds. The signal lasts about 10 seconds. One interesting thing is that this idea that the shockwave goes, you know, out from the center of the star after the collapse, and that makes the star explode, that is not at all correct. So this is known because the binding energy of the material outside is of the order of 10 to the 51 Hertz. And the kinetic energy of this shockwave is comparable. So just in order to, you know, break apart the material, you will use up all the kinetic energy that is there in the shockwave. But on top of that, you also have to create this optical display that you see, and you have to, you know, and we have to also see all these neutrinos. So clearly, we just simply do not have enough energy for the star to explode, purely because of this shockwave on its own breaking through the material. So this is best illustrated by this cartoon, is that until about the 1960s, people thought that the supernova mechanism, explosion mechanism, was the following, that there's a collapse and then thing bounces and then something happens and it explodes. But no one really knows, like, what is that miracle? The answer is that, 99% of the energy of this star actually goes into neutrinos. Only 1% goes into this kinetic energy. So if a small fraction of the neutrino energy, so neutrinos are non-interacting and most of them are just leaking out of the star. But if even a small fraction of them interact back in the star after they're emitted from the inner hot core of the star, then the shock can be energized, and then that leads to the explosion. This is known as the delayed neutrino mechanism of supernova explosions. This is not something that has been settled. This is a very old problem of why supernovae explode. Great scientists like Bethe have been interested in this problem. One of the objectives of everything that we are doing is to discover the supernova explosion mechanism, is to discover precisely how stars explode. Okay. So we believe that neutrinos need to hit the shock, but we will see that even that does not quite happen. So let's see. The reason is that there is this central part of the star, up to a distance of, let's say, this R nu, everything inside this, where the neutrinos are trapped. You know, they have such strong interactions that they can't come out. They only diffuse out. Okay. at this point, the neutrinos can start coming out, traveling in straight lines. In the inner part of the star, you know, in this area, in this single hatched area, if you will, the star is radiating heat roughly at some rate, like some constant times the Stefan Boltzmann constant, times T to the power 4, whatever is the temperature. And once you go a little bit outside the star, this region is heating up at a rate, whatever is the neutron luminosity coming out from the inner regions, multiplied by the cross section, times 1 over 4 pi r square. You know, L by 4 pi r square is roughly how many neutrinos you get in a given one. And so if you equate, you know, the heating rate due to stars coming from the central region of the star, there is a particular radius, you know, shown here in this gray circle, which is called the gain radius, which you can compute. This gain radius is something like, say, 70 kilometers, you know, in this star, this supernova. Now, if you want to deposit energy in the star, it's very obvious that most of the interactions will actually happen very close to just above the gain radius. Why? Because the density is falling very sharply, and the probability of interaction therefore falls very sharply as you go further away from the gain radius. So you have to deposit energy somewhere around here, and the shock is here. So this is like, you know, you have some material and you heat it from below, and so there will be bubbling and Kelvin instabilities will happen, and that is what is going to drive the shock forward. You know, that's the method that we think should happen. Unfortunately, what happens is that the neutrinos that can interact with the stellar material is made of protons, neutrons, and electrons. So the thing that has strongest interactions with protons, neutrons, and electrons are electron neutrinos, so nu e's. But nu e's have the smallest energies out of the nu e's, nu e bars, nu mu's, and nu mu bars. So the star emits nu e electron neutrino, electron antineutrino, muon neutrino, muon antineutrino, tau neutrino, and tau antineutrino. So there are the six kinds of neutrinos, of which these do not have that much interaction because they only interact via neutral current, so the Z boson, and therefore they decouple deeper in the star, have higher energies, but then they will not interact again. Whereas these neutrinos have interactions also through W. Okay, and then the W boson is slightly lighter than the Z boson, so the interactions of these are a little bit stronger, but as a result, they are emitted from the further out regions of the star. They have lower average energies, and you can see the cross section goes as energy square. Cross section goes as energy to the power 2, gf square e square. That is the cross section, and the luminosity also depends on energy. So overall, there are three powers of energy in this expression. And the three powers of E nu. So the heating rate goes as the cube of the neutrino energy, and the electron neutrino is very inefficient because it has energy of, let's say, 10 MeV, whereas the other neutrinos, let's say nu mu or nu tau, they have energies which is of the order of, let's say, 18 MeV. So if by some way we could make the muon and the tau neutrinos convert to electron neutrinos by Newton oscillations, then now the non-electron flavors, these flavors which have the higher energies, have converted to the electron flavor, maintaining their energy. And if they now interact, they will deposit more energy. Is this clear? Is this argument clear? That if I start with a high energy muon neutrino, flavor converted to an electron neutrino, that will lead to greater heat deposition in the star. Okay. This is what is being shown here. On the x-axis is the time since the bounce of the star. On the y-axis is various kinds of radii. So the black line, you know, the dark black line, that is don't focus on the black line, sorry. This line, let's say, this dashed line, so this one, and then it oscillates like this here. This line is the radius at which the shock wave exists. Okay, and this hatched area, this one, is the region where 75% of the heating due to neutrinos happens, and that is just above the gain radius, which is here. Okay, now one can show that normally neutrino oscillations will not happen, you know, before you reach the shock. Now, they usually happen at these distances that are being shown in green and black. Okay, so at this black line is 5% neutron oscillation. At the green line, you can have something like 90% neutron oscillation. So whatever it is, they are much, much, much larger, the radii, than this region where most of the heating needs to happen. And so therefore, ordinarily, neutron oscillations cannot lead to enhanced heating of the star causing explosions. However, let's say there was some unknown mechanism which allowed neutrinos to convert already at this radius, just before or around the gain radius in the star. Then one can show that the heating enhancement can be approximately a factor of 2, as opposed to this factor of 1%. So it's very clear that neutrino oscillations, if they can occur very deep in the star, they will have a huge impact on the neutrino enhanced supernova explosion mechanism. This is the reason why the problem that we are working on is interesting. You will see that, you know, the mechanism that we talked about makes such a thing possible. So just a few things to keep in mind. The typical luminosity of neutrinos coming out of a star as a function of time. Time here is in seconds. You can see 0.0 seconds, so 0.6 seconds. The luminosity is of the order of, in the units of 10 to the 53 Earths, it is roughly point. So few times, so luminosity is L is few times 10 to the 53 Earths. Okay, so that's the unit that is typically used, ergs in this case. Sorry, that's a luminosity. And the typical energy is of the order of 10 to, let's say, 20 MeV. So the average energy of each neutrino is something like 10 to 20. 10 more for things like nu E and 20 or 18 for nu mu tau, etc. Okay. So that's, and for nu E bar, it's somewhere in between. You can see that the blue is nu E, that's more like 10, so this is nu E, and the red is nu E bar, that's more like, let's say, 13 nu R. The black is nu X, which is 15. Okay, so that's the hierarchy of energies, and this is happening because these different neutrinos have different cross sections. Okay, so now we come to the real part of my talk, where I will show you how a new kind of oscillation will happen very deep in the star. Fast oscillation will happen very deep in the star. This collective fast effect that I was talking about at the very beginning, how that happens very deep in the star, and that may affect the explosion of the star. You will need a little bit of new language to talk about neutron oscillations. So most of us are very familiar with the language of Schrodinger equation. So this is something like the Schrodinger equation. We are also familiar with the other version of this quantum mechanics equation, which is the von Neumann or Heisenberg equation, where instead of a state, we talk about a density matrix. And instead of this operator acting on the state, what you have on the right hand side is a commutator of the Hamiltonian with the density matrix. And the dot, dot, dot term now can include in principle, let's see how we will make that work. Okay, not too bad. Okay. So the dot, dot, dot here corresponds to terms that lead to collisions. Collisions meaning that things that destroy the coherence of the density matrix, because that cannot be contained in the Hamiltonian. Hamiltonian evolution does not lead to destruction of the purity of a state. Pure states remain pure. And what must appear here are thermal and other.
Can anybody think that to be something called Lindbladian in open quantum system?
Yeah, so Lindblad is a specific realization of what can be a collision term. But I'm going to be very, very, very general. But I'll say that everything that is not a Hamiltonian, the Hamiltonian is straightforward. It needs to be a Hermitian matrix.
Mm-hmm.
That is all that matters.
Mm-hmm.
And anything that is not on the right hand side, which is a commutator of a Hermitian matrix with a density matrix, mm-hmm. within the dot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it can be anything. Lindbladian is an example, indeed.
Okay. So this might be an open system, one of the examples.
It certainly is an open system.
Okay.
And it is an open system because we are talking about neutrinos in some bar, right? So there is a star, and the star is acting on the neutrino.
Yeah, true.
So thermal contributions, there are finite temperature, finite density contributions. But you will see that those things are not important. It is very easy to get decoherence by using this.
Yes.
I will get decoherence without using this. Of course, that is impossible, right? So, but I will do the impossible because I will define decoherence in a slightly interesting way. It is not true decoherence, it is apparent decoherence. And you will see that there is some apparent decoherence that will appear because of even just the Hamiltonian evolution. Okay. So that's the magic part. You will see when that appears. There's a third way of looking at Newton oscillations where what you do is you take each of these matrices, density matrices, let's say, and you write it as a linear combination. So for example, you can write rho is equal to something proportional to the unit matrix. Let's call it E0 by 2 times the unit matrix. So now you can see that the trace of rho is equal to, if the trace of rho has to be 1 if it's normalized correctly. So P0 is a number, and let's say it is equal to therefore 1. Okay, so unit matrix trace is 2, and then there's a factor of half in front, and so rho is equal to half times unity, plus some vectors, some three component vector in flavor space, not in physical space, in flavor space.
This is basically called block vector decomposition of a density matrix.
Right.
Yes.
That is exactly correct. So these are called block vectors or polarization vectors. And if you do that, this equation I del t of rho is commutator of h rho becomes del t of p is b times p, where p is nothing but the vector that will appear here when you decompose h. H therefore goes as b dot sigma by 2. And why does the commutator become a cross product? Because the commutator is nothing but epsilon ij k of sigma j sigma k. But epsilon ij k is nothing but exactly the same thing that leads to the Lovichi-Vidal tensor is exactly what defines the cross product.
Yes.
Or three component vector.
Yes.
If you want to work with more than two flavors, then this Hamiltonian will not be a 2x2 matrix. It will be a Hermitian matrix. But let's say for three flavors, it will be a 3x3 matrix. Rho will also be a 3x3 matrix. But you can play the same game. Instead of polymatrices, you can use the Gell-Mann matrices, which are the basis of 3x3 Hermitian matrices. Okay, traceless matrices. And then all that happens is that this cross should be interpreted as Fijk, which are the structure constants of SU3 instead of the structure constants of SU2. So there's three languages in which two-level or n-level oscillations can be talked about. One is a Schrodinger picture. The second is this density matrix picture. And the third is this block vector. Okay, so we have to be comfortable in going from one to the other. I will effortlessly use one language or the other. For example, I can talk about a two-level system that starts in one state and as a function of time oscillates to the other, the probability. I can talk about a density matrix for a particular neutrino that under the action of Hamiltonian corresponds to one state or the other state, always a pure state if collisions are not important, but one flavor or the other. I can talk about a polarization vector that is recessing around some pseudo-magnetic field. This B is not really a magnetic field. It is just some representation of the flavor Hamiltonian as a pseudo-magnetic field. And this P is something like a pseudo-spin. The pseudo here basically means that it is not really a spin. It is just some, you know, something that mathematically looks like a spin precessing around the magnet. And so I will talk about these three different languages. And the precession of a spin basically says that the projection of the spin vector in the vertical direction should be thought of as the probability. And that oscillates sinusoidally. Okay? This is my responsibility to show the full equation, so I do it. On the left, so this is in the density matrix language. On the left hand side, I have I capital D of some density matrix. The density matrix, each of the density matrices, so there are lots of neutrinos. I will label them by their momentum p, each of the density matrices, at some position x. You know, so I am thinking of phase space, a little volume of phase space. In each little volume of phase space, I can therefore define a p. You know, that's the label of that phase space volume. And there is a certain x that I'm not writing. There's some special index x. What is acting on this density matrix? I times the derivative, total derivative, which is nothing but del t plus v dot del x. Okay, this is, I can also write p dot, f dot del p, which is the term that shows how momentum is changed. But let's just say that there are no external forces. So this is the advection term. This is just the ambivalence. The first term is the familiar term that happens because the neutrino masses of the two states are different. Okay, so this is just the mass square matrix. This you should be familiar with because what appears, you know, E is equal to square root p square plus m square for relativistic particles. Now, if I take the, you know, p outside because the momentum of a neutron is much larger than the mass, then this looks like p times 1 plus m square by p square to the power half. Okay. And this therefore looks like p plus m square by twice p. Now you see this p does not depend on m. So all the mass eigenstates, they get a common contribution, which I can drop because that's just an overall global phase in the Hamiltonian. You can add a constant to the Hamiltonian. It will not change anything. So the only relevant part of the Hamiltonian is m squared by this, which is a p. There's a second term, which goes as square root 2 times the G Fermi. G Fermi is something like 1 over mw squared. Okay. Times this L matrix. L is nothing but 1, 0, 0. It's a diagonal matrix. You know, because these neutrinos are interacting with electrons in the background. And the first index in flavor basis is electron. That's why there is a 1 here. If there were muons and taus in the background, there would also be something here proportional to their number density. Okay. And third term is exactly the same as the second term, where you see this rho minus rho bar counts the abundance of neutrinos in the bath. Okay, and there is a commutator with the pth neutrino, which I am interested in. And there is this 1 minus cos theta factor, which here in this term is not there, because the relative, let's say, momenta of neutrinos and electrons can be random, because all different neutrinos are going in different directions. It's isotropic, and I have averaged over them. But for neutrinos, I want to track the behavior of each momentum mode separately. So I have to keep track of this relative angle. Okay, and then I do an integral over all possible momenta of the qth neutrino, d3q by 2 pi q, 1 minus the angle between the two neutrino trajectories, and commutator of the density matrices of the rho and the rho p and the rho q. Now, see, the antineutrinos appear with a minus sign here.
So this cos term is kind of this p dot p wala factor.
That's exactly what I said before, indeed. And this comes from the V minus A structure of weak interactions.
Yeah.
Weak interactions have a V minus A structure. That is what gives this 1 minus cos. Now, one thing to note is that every term in this equation has the dimensions of 1 over time, a rate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just by dimensional analysis. So, and density matrices are dimensionless.
Yes.
Density matrices do not have a dimension. So it's very clear that I should think of each of these terms as something multiplying the density matrix with a dimension of 1 over time. And so there are three rates in the problem. One rate comes from this term, which is delta m squared, the difference of the squares of the masses of the two neutrinos divided by twice energy. P and E are the same in the limit, you know, that the mass goes to zero. Okay, so this is called the vacuum oscillation frequency, or the oscillation frequency in vacuum. Here there is going to be another rate, which is root 2 gf, which is here, times the electron number density. And the finally, here there is a particular rate that will go as root 2 gf times the neutrino number. So there are three rates. Okay, and in general, this is a very complicated problem, because I have to worry about, you know, neutrinos of three different, you know, momentum components. I have motion in time, I have motion in space, d3x, d3p, dt, and this seven-dimensional phase-space problem I am solving not for just the phase space density f, which you are maybe familiar with in fluid dynamics or something like that. But now the f, the phase space density, has been promoted to a matrix, this density matrix. This is actually nothing but the Wigner transform, okay, of the density matrix. Basically, you know, you should already get a little bit scared that I'm talking about a neutrino with momentum p at position x. How is this even possible? How can I specify x and p at the same time? I should not be able to do that. The answer is you can do that if you are going to talk about x and p coarse-grained, or, you know, only up to some large resolution in some classical limit. So the motion, so the kinematic motion of the neutrino, I'm going to treat classical. You know, they have nice trajectories. They're going. I don't have to do quantum mechanics about the motion of the neutrino itself. That's why I can do this. But the internal motion, the internal dynamics of the state, that I'm going to treat quantum mechanical. And that's where this I appears. This equation is a quantum mechanical equation, but it is a quantum mechanical equation for the internal state of the neutrinos. The kinematic motion is treated completely classical. Is this clear?
Yes, to me it is clear. I don't know about others. Guys, if you have question, please ask. Other, I think.
Sir.
Yeah, there is a
question.
Please
sir,
ask.
The equation, the two.
Your connection is not very sphere. So can you
explain the term we are using it for, considering the scattered sublet? So,
I couldn't get the question.
Can you speak again?
I'm asking, sir. Can you just tell me in the RHS?
Sorry, I'm not hearing the question at
Hello?
All. Yeah. Hello? Maybe you can type your question if it's a short question, or you can try one more time and let's see if it works. No? Sorry, I think maybe the connection is too poor.
I think it's not very clear. So you can proceed, maybe he will ask later.
And maybe we can come back to it then.
Yeah.
Okay, so this all looks very complicated at this point. I'm sorry.
I'll try to.
So this equation, of course, looks very complicated, and it is complicated. There's no way that, you know, one can solve this equation as is. It's a partial differential equation if you think about it, because these are all derivatives, del p, del t, del x. And there is an integral over momenta. So it's not just a partial differential equation, it's a partial integral differential equation. I don't know if you've ever seen such equations in your life before. And not only is it a partial integral differential equation, it is a partial integral differential equation acting on matrices, not functions. You know, rho is a matrix. So it's really a monster equation. Okay, but we will try to make sense of this equation as we go along. So as I told you, the main point is that why oscillations are important is that they affect, they are an interference effect, and they add to things at first order in perturbation theory, not second order. So what do I mean by that? That imagine that I have a neutrino that is going like this. It has some momentum p. It can just do this. It has some amplitude for that. I call that free propagation amplitude. Or it can go like this by having a forward scattering with something in the bath, I don't care what, without changing its momentum. Okay? Now this has some amplitude. You know, this is some amplitude called a forward scattering. And the total amplitude square is, you know, this plus this, because these are indistinguishable for the observer, right? Whether you have had a forward scattering or not cannot be determined in principle, right? So therefore, even if you could observe the target particle, the one that it scatters against, even then you will not know, because that particle also just did not change its momentum. But Feynman says that indistinguishable things have to be added in amplitude. So I do that. Let us say that this A forward scattering is in some sense smaller than A free, although these are complex numbers, and whether you can talk about small or big is a different story. But what happens is that this mod square is the A free square plus some interference term plus a term that goes like A forward scattering mod square, which I will now ignore. Now this is a real object, I will ignore this relativeness. But you see, the extra term that I get is linear in the amplitude of the forward scattering. And therefore, this appears with 1 power of g per, just the coupling constant, as opposed to true scattering, true collisions, which will only appear here, and they would appear with gf squared. Now, g per is a small number in whatever units you want to work with. And if you are able to selectively make sure that order G Fermi terms are important, but order G Fermi square terms are not important, then you have a situation where neutrino oscillations are affected by forward scattering of particles in the bath, but no collisions are actually happening. Okay, is that good?
Yes.
This is just a more field theoretic description of the same thing. that a neutrino can interact with either neutrinos or electrons in the bath in these two ways. And as long as there is no momentum change, the amplitude must be added to free propagation and contributes at order g. Because you see, there is one factor of g here, and g squared by 8, so 2 root 2 mw square is defined as g per me. So it's very clear that this amplitude goes as just g per me. There's no g per me square. Okay. Now, the next complication is that imagine two neutrinos, you know, nu e and nu mu with momentum k and q. They interact. I don't want to even say what happened here. This happened through some WZ boson, what, don't care. I'm using effective field theory now. I've integrated out the W and Z bosons. So the nu mu can be in the final state with the same momentum q, and or it could be with a different momentum k. You know, so the only difference between these two diagrams is that the momentum of the two final state particles has been exchanged. Now, unless you're measuring the flavor, these two amplitudes are indistinguishable again. And neutrino oscillations is all about the case where you're not yet measured the flavor. We are trying to find out what is the probability to get some particle in some given flavor, right? And so therefore, both of these amplitudes will add, and one can show that it leads to a contribution in the Hamiltonian, this amplitude, which is off diagonal. This one is in the off diagonal. This comes from this term, the term where the momenta are exchanged. And this was discovered by Jim Pantaleoni in about 1990. So this is not that long ago. You know, this is a standard model effect, but this was discovered something like 28 years ago, 30 years ago. Okay. Now, this will only happen when the number density of neutrinos is very high, because that's when neutrinos will interact with other neutrinos. So this is important in three places in the universe. First is in the early universe, this happens. The neutrino bath in the early universe was doing this. Second place it happens is in supernovae, which is what we will talk about. And the third place is merger of neutron stars. That also produces lots of neutrinos, and there that this thing can happen. This is interesting for LIGO and these kind of observations. Anyway, so neutrino oscillations are a fairly rich phenomena. It also depends on the background density, electron density in the bath. There's a lot of very interesting physics here, but let me skip that a little bit. So basically the main point here is that neutrinos, as they travel through the density of the star, they are sensitive to the density in various ways. And by looking at the probability of seeing some particular flavor of neutrino or not, you can learn something about the density that it traveled through. And this dependence is very sensitive because it depends on linear order in Fermi constant, G Fermi, not GF squared. So interference effects, just like LIGO. Why is LIGO so sensitive? Because LIGO measures interference effects. So same is true here. Neutrinos are very sensitive probes because they allow us to measure things using interference between two flavors. Now, when there are lots of neutrinos, we will have collective effects. What will happen? That when GF times number density of neutrinos is much larger than this delta m squared by this vacuum oscillating frequency term, then neutrinos of different frequencies become synchronized. So what is being plotted here, these two different colors, the red and the blue here, correspond to two neutrinos of different energy, let's say E1 and E2, where E1 and E2 are different. And if they were oscillating independently, their frequencies would depend on energy as 1 over E, and these two, you know, would look more like, so one of them would be this, the other would be something like this, and they would not oscillate together. But in high density, they oscillate together. It's called synchronized oscillation. This is not what I'm going to talk about later, but this is also a kind of collective effect, but this is not fast collective effect. This is still what I would call medium, you know, speed collective effect, the average. As the density gets lower, in principle, other interesting things can happen. Non-sinusoidal oscillations can take place, but even here, the frequency of oscillation at best is of the order of square root omega. So omega, okay. So this is the frequency, is the geometric mean of this vacuum oscillation frequency and this frequency mu, which is gf times n mu, and it's the geometric mean of the two frequencies. But still, this is not proportional to n nu, which is what I had called fast. Fast frequency was where it was linearly proportional to the neutrinos in the path. So that we still have to get to. So let's skip a bunch of things. Maybe this is interesting. So now, main one interesting point is that if you think about it, this we have already gotten an equation of the kind I d dt of rho, let's say some ith rho, is commutator of some Hamiltonian with rho. And this Hamiltonian curves is a function of all the rho j's. Of course, it does not contain rho I. You know, it's a nice Hamiltonian equation. But if I think of a super density matrix, which is something like, you know, let's say make a big vector with rho 1, rho 2, rho 3, you know, as a very big density matrix. So the density matrix corresponds to the entire neutron ensemble with all the neutrinos taken together. This object has an equation that depends on itself. You know, so the Hamiltonian for this big object, rho big, let's call it, depends on rho big. So the equation is of the kind I dt of rho is equal to commutator of h rho, except that h depends on rho. This never happens in quantum mechanics. This is not linear. This problem there is not linear because it depends on rho in some very complicated nonlinear way. So one way to solve these complicated nonlinear problems is to linearize. Now we are starting with some very specific state. Let's say all the neutrinos are in some flavor state. So in that basis, the density matrix is diagonal. Okay, so this is diagonal, some number trace of the density matrix times identity, times the part that is not diagonal, where very clearly we will say that this capital S is a very small object. Capital S is mod capital S is much, much smaller than mod. We will say that modulus of capital S, this one, is much, much less than mod. So this is the initial starting point. And then we can take our equation and linearize it in this S. And what we will find is an eigenvalue equation for S. This eigenvalue equation then tells us, the solution to the eigenvalue equation for S then tells us, what is the rate at which this S tends to grow? That if I start with some very small value of S, how fast does it grow? That is what linear stability analysis gives us. And one can do that, but the problem with this approach is that this is a linearized approach. It tells you what happens very early on. You know, initially, how does the system behave? But once S becomes of order 1 or even order 0.1 or 0.3, this linearized treatment does not work. And it does not tell you what is the final state of the system. This has been a problem for the last 20 years or so. You can, of course, solve the problem numerically. And what you find is that, you know, in this case, is whatever, as a function of z, you are seeing something is changing and it's changing a lot. And we want to find this pollution, this late time nonlinear solution, but we can't do that with linear stability analysis. We have to have some new technique. That is what I will now tell you. But I will tell you about this problem in the context of what I will do fast oscillations. So let's come to this. See, very deep in the star, as I told you, the different flavors of neutrinos, they decouple at slightly different radii. Why? Because they have different interactions. So the electron neutrino decouples the last, you know, this new E is shown here. That, so it decouples roughly here. The new E bar decouples here. So the new E bar is decoupling here. And then new X, the other neutrinos decouple. So new mu tau and their antiparticles, they decouple here. But because they have decoupled here, by the time I'm looking at this point in space, a little bit outside the star, its emission distribution as a function of angle is much more forward peaked because it has already decoupled. It is not isotropically scattering in all directions. It is mostly going in the forward direction. Whereas the electron neutrino, the blue arrows, if you see, they are much more isotropic because it is still just decoupling, and so therefore it is, you know, going in all directions almost equal. As a result, you see the angle dependent distribution, phase space distributions of these different neutrinos are different, and most importantly, if you pay the attention to the new E and the new E bar, which is the red and the blue curves, you will see that there is a crossing. The blue curve is this one, the red curve is this one, and the blue one is here. And at this angle, there's this direction along which these two distributions are crossed. If you look at angles that are here, you have more new E. If you are looking at angles here, you have more new E bar. So in the forward direction, there are more antineutrinos. In the backward direction, there are more neutrinos. This is something that happens just naturally, like just known laws of physics provide for this. Once this happens, this allows for some very interesting instabilities to exist in these, you know, equations. So, you know, if you write an equation of this kind for the problem, it turns out that S, if you write it like this and look for an eigenvalue solution for this S, the frequency omega, and this is not the delta m squared by 2ic, let me just in fact write it as omega can be imaginary or complex. Omega becomes complex. But what does that mean? That means that S, which goes as e to the power minus I omega t, goes as e to the power minus I imaginary part of omega times t with I, and I square is minus one. So there's, of course, the equation is real. So there's both real and imaginary parts appear as conjugates, the two imaginary parts, but basically it goes as e to the power imaginary part of omega times t. And this is an exponentially growing quantity. So S grows exponentially. So which means that the flavor conversion happens exponentially fast. So initially we started with almost diagonal matrices, but now the off-diagonal matrix grows exponentially because of an instability. The instability happens when omega, this capital omega that I just showed above, it has an imaginary part. When does that happen? That happens when the spectra of the two flavors have a crossing. Okay? So this is something that I will not do. This is known in the literature for a long time. Okay, so now now I'm going to specifically talk about one of our results. This result is done by one of my students. So I'm going to show his face for 2 seconds. The papers can be found here. You can look up the reference later. What we have achieved in this paper is we have solved this problem first numerically, and then analytically to look at the final late time state. So we have not just done linear stability analysis. We have solved the nonlinear problem with some analytical tricks and characterized the final late time state, which then agrees with the numerical results. Okay. So what is shown here is an example. This is the time direction. This is space. So normally I would solve the problem in three spatial dimensions, three momentum dimensions, and one time dimension. Seven dimension is what I have to do. But that is very hard. So what we do is we solve it in one momentum dimension, one space dimension, and one time dimension. So this we can do. One should think of this in a way that when you're very close to the neutrino sphere where neutrinos are emitted, it should, the source looks like an infinite wall. And so the only direction of space that is relevant, interesting, is the one that is perpendicular to it. So, and that is this dimension. Okay. And the only angle that is interesting is the one that it makes with this spatial dimension. And that is this momentum direction, theta. And of course, time is there. So what we find is that initially everything is its initial state, starting at one, time is on the x-axis, and the different neutrinos being emitted in different directions. So what I have in mind here is that this is a wall. This is the direction that is going out of the supernova. And neutrinos are emitted from each point on this wall in all possible directions. And I label them by different colors. You know, so the different colors here correspond to different angles of emission. All of them start in some initial state, let's say electron neutrino state. But as time goes on, some of them, they stay roughly in their initial state, close to one. And some of them, they go in the other state, close to minus 0.5, minus one. Now, this is only showing the third component of the polarization vector. But if you actually look at it by averaging over space, you know, we take some little volume of space and average over it. What we will find is that initially, let's say the red arrow here, the one that I'm showing here, the red arrow corresponds to states which are pointing, you know, in one, some given direction, say one. And the blue arrows are these states, which are also pointing up. Initially, so both of the states are pointing at one. Initially, this is one. Finally, this stays close to one, but the blue vectors, they have gone to something like minus 0.5. So there's a tendency for some of the polarization vectors corresponding to the flavor state to tip over, and the length shrinks. Instead of being of single, of fixed length one, their length becomes smaller. So this is clearly irreversible behavior because, you know, it goes there and does not come back. And in fact, the length shrinks, you know, which should not happen in quantum mechanics. You know, trace of rho square, these things are conserved. So what is going on? What is going on is an effect of coarse graining the system. So the polarization vectors are defined as this S. Each of these S is a three component vector, S1, S2, S3. And I do that for each velocity mode, each direction. And I make moments out of it. These Ls are Legendre polynomials. Ls are what we would normally call PL in, you know, PM in our mathematical physics course, the Legendre polynomials. GV is just, you know, the function that describes the relative abundance of each angular mode. And you do an integral like this and define a moment M. Okay. Now you can convert the equation for S into an equation for MN, but you don't just do that. You also do a little coarse graining that you, so the equation, if you remember, was something like del T plus V del X acting on something, let's say S, equal to whatever is on the right hand side. If you do an integral over dx from, let's say, some x naught minus delta x by 2 and x delta, let's say, L by 2 and x naught plus delta L by 2. This term, second term, because of periodic boundary conditions on this little box of size L, will just disappear. So we convert the partial differential equation into an ordinary differential equation with just t. And there were lots of velocities which were being integrated over the integral part of the integral partial differential equation. The integral part is converted to partial derivatives with respect to the multiple number. So instead of doing integrals over some variable v, we do derivatives with respect to its conjugate variable when we do this Legendre transformation, and that's n. Okay, so we convert this partial integral differential equation into a pure partial differential equation. This is a pure partial differential equation. So del t of something is del n square of that thing plus 1 over n del n of that thing with some coefficient in front. Now we notice something very beautiful. In this partial differential equation, notice that if you take n and multiply it by some constant a, and you take time t and multiply it by some constant a square, this equation remains invariant. You know, this t gets a factor of 1 over a square here. Del n square here gets a factor of 1 over a square. There's an n here and there's a del n here. And so overall that gets a factor of 1 over a square. And so it cancels from both sides. Of course, a is not zero. So by scaling with respect to time and multiple number in a specific way, I show that the partial differential equation does not change in its form, which means that the solution for average mn, so average mn, is only a function of this kind. So average mn depends on t, but only in the form n square over t, because then the a cancels. It's some function not of n and t independently, but some joint function of n square over t. Once you plug this in, you can convert this PDE to an ODE, which has an exact solution, which you can write down. You know, it's average mn is some constant c1 times the error integral function of n square by t, with some overall prefactor plus some other constant. Okay, so it's an exact solution to this equation. And what this exact solution then tells us is that the moments of the polarization vector, they diffuse. So what does that mean? It means that, you see, what is plotted here as a different color are the lengths of the polarization vectors for different moments. The dark colors are lower moments, and they are the ones which are, you know, large initially. And something happens and then eventually they decay. Whereas these light colors, they start with some very small values and then they grow and they go. Eventually all the moments roughly become of the same size, almost of the same size. What is this saying? This says that if you initially start with the system with basically a very, you know, smooth behavior, as let's say even constant in V, now then it has only the monopole moment. Once you let all the fast collective oscillations happen, it leads to all possible moments, you know, then your function has all the higher order terms, which means that it's a very complicated function of V. So all the multiple moments exist. And that's what's going on. So this is irreversibility, because as you can see, power has diffused from one multiple moment into all the other multiple moments. Why has that happened? Because I have coarse grained over two things. First, I have coarse grained over velocity. You know, by doing these multiple moments, I've integrated over certain ranges of velocity. And when I truncate my equation at some multiple moment, I'm throwing away information on smaller and smaller scales of V. you know, I don't have any information beyond some, you know, small scales in me. But I have also integrated over space, delta x. Both of these kinds of coarse graining are how I have gotten irreversibility out. Now you can ask, is this just some mathematical trick that you have done to get some irreversible answer, or is this actually going to happen in the real world? You know, will neutrinos actually, you know, go into some sort of a irreversible state? The answer is yes. The physics of it is the following. That power, so, you know, initially, if you think in terms of phase space, there is some very smooth solution on phase space. As time progresses, the solution over phase space becomes some very complicated and very noisy function. It keeps becoming noisy until this noise reaches the quantum, you know, this delta x, delta p of the order of h bar scale, at which point it cannot, you know, at which point it cannot diffuse anymore. But already by this time, you have made the system sufficiently chaotic, if you will, such that if you are going to measure the system with an apparatus that is sensitive only to delta x and delta p, that is somewhat larger than the quantum scale, which is what will happen in real life, you will measure the average over some big macroscopic volume, which does not retain all the information that you initially had. Okay. And this is most beautifully described in terms of the physics of relaxation. So which let me show you. So what happens in this case is that, let's say you start everything again at one, you know, as a function of time, some of them stay at one, some of them point, you know, downwards, go close to zero. And this happens because of the way the Hamiltonian for each of these polarization vectors behaves. But I think a picture is more interesting. So what happens is the following. Imagine that there are a lot of these polarization vectors in some given spatial volume. They're all initially pointing up. And I can think of this collection of polarization vectors as some sort of a, you know, I would say a majority vector like this. And once these vectors tip over, they go like this. The majority vector also tips like this. But once they reach this transverse plane, one can show that the different members of this big majority vector, they do not remain coherent anymore. They span out on the plane and their length does not shrink. Each of these maintains its length. But if I'm talking about the majority vector being just the sum of the each of these vectors, its length can shrink and does shrink. So what we have is not really decoherence, but dephasing. Because the component, the individual spins that make up this, you know, macroscopic spin, dephase with respect to each other. And that is why the length shrinks. Another way of thinking about it is, imagine here you have a magnet, big magnet, which is made of lots of spins pointing in one direction. That magnetic needle has some magnetic moment, some macroscopic magnetic moment. Now, if I scramble the internal spins of this magnet, the overall magnetic moment would shrink. This we don't call decoherence because each individual spin, its magnetic moment has not changed. No, that cannot change. That's a quantum mechanical property of the spin. But if I'm going to coarse grain over little volumes by adding a whole bunch of such true microscopic spins, the moment of the macroscopic little pellet inside the domain, that can change. And that is what is going on. As a result, what happens is that the different flavors get mixed up. So initially, if you have, let's say, only electron neutrinos, what you end up with finally is a 50-50, let's say, mixture of electron neutrinos and electron and muon neutrinos. So electron neutrinos and muon neutrinos. So flavor conversion happens. we can then analytically compute as a function of this angle is v, the velocity, and as a function of properties of this initial distribution of these neutrinos, exactly how much of this depolarization happens. Okay, and that's given by this formula. Okay, so we have predicted, therefore, the final state, you know, the irreversible final state of a nonlinear partial integral differential equation acting over matrices to predict the final state of neutrino flavor inside supernovae. And this has impact. Why? Because now you have converted flavor, and this will happen on very short time scales. In fact, you can show that the time scale that this is happening over is picoseconds. It's happening within 10, 15 picoseconds. Okay, so now this is a new mechanism for conversion of neutrino flavor from electron neutrinos to some other neutrinos and vice versa. So the thing that I had told you about, you know, at the very beginning, that the way to explode a star could be flavor change very early on. This might be a way to do it. Now, this is, of course, not experimentally verified yet. And this is some work in progress. We have done some work. There are other people who have also done work. I think I have put some citations, but you can find more in the paper. If this really happens inside supernovae, we might expect this physics to play an important role in how the star explodes. Okay. So let's finish with an analogy. So the analogy is that a congregation of agents, you know, n number of neutrinos, is evolving faster than any given neutrino. This is like if you imagine you have a marching band with 100 people, and just because there are 100 people packed in that little volume, they start marching so fast, you know, in tune and in, you know, synchrony, that they beat Usain Bolt. 100 people marching together, their frequency increases to 100 times the speed of one person, and therefore it starts beating Usain Bolt. So that's what this fast collective effect is telling you about neutrinos. It's a very bizarre, very interesting effect. But what would you expect to happen if this were really the case in real life? That this marching band, if it tries to run too fast, they will just completely get entangled with each other and just fall over, right? It'll become like some big mess. And this is exactly also what happens in neutrinos, that it does evolve very fast and collectively for the first 10 or 15 picoseconds. But then after that, it just becomes a mess and it becomes like a chaos. Okay, that's the intuitive or heuristic understanding of why there is irreversible flavor depolarization of supernova neutrinos. Okay, and then if this happens, we expect the heating to happen here. It might lead to very efficient supernova explosions. It might also have impact on neutron star mergers, because the R process nucleosynthesis gets affected by neutrinos, and LIGO is detecting these BNS mergers. So we might do electromagnetic follow-ups like the kilonova event that was seen 2 years or so ago. And in that case, we will be able to measure the abundance of all the nuclear isotopes, which might give us some indication about whether or not this process is going on there. We will be able to measure some with maybe not very high precision, but with enough data, we will be able to measure the survival probability of neutrinos inside these BNS mergers, and that will tell us whether or not these fast effects have happened. Okay, so that's another interesting thing. One of the things that you can do is you can try to look for signatures of these fast collective effects on the neutrinos, because eventually these neutrinos will come to Earth, and there are detectors which can detect these neutrinos, and the number of events that you can detect not these effects will happen. And so, for example, this red curve is the case where you have these fuzz effects. This green is one where you don't. And you can see that the error bars, you know, are small. You can distinguish this from that. So detection is possible. You can actually try to look for this. So if there is a supernova in our galaxy, it happens once in 100 years, once in 30 years, somewhere in between, we might have an opportunity to discover this new process, fast collective flavor conversion, by looking at supernova. Okay, so let me finish here that neutrino self-interactions, this forward scattering of neutrinos, can lead to large flavor changes. The final state is a partial irreversible mixing of the distributions of the new E's and the new E's. The level of this partial mixing, the mixing factor, depends on the ratio of new E's and new bars and the initial spectrum, you know, as a function of in which angle how many neutrinos and antineutrinos are being emitted. The formula that we have can be used in simulations to check if the star explodes more easily or not. And it can be used to compute the observable neutrino signals at Earth. And although we've done it for some very simple initial conditions, this can be extended to at least somewhat more general initial conditions without any problem. Okay. So I think that's all I want to absolutely say. I will stop here. And if there are questions, I can take them.
So we are thankful to Basu for giving such an elaborative overview on the subject, which I truly believe for me itself, I have learned a lot. I believe the other people also have learned a lot. So please ask questions if you have, please. So the guy who have written something in the chat box, he can ask directly, and somebody due to the connection you couldn't able to ask some question, you can able to ask those questions, please. Anything specific?
I see a question already from Bhavya Singhal. Why, what is the reason for this anisotropy in other neutrons? Very good. So that's a good question. Let me answer that. So maybe I will do this. See, if a particle is interacting a lot, it's interacting a lot with the medium, it goes everywhere. Then if you consider a little phase space, little volume, that's a little spatial volume, you will find that neutrinos are going in all directions. Is that clear? This should be totally clear, right? But imagine this is the star. And the particle inside the depth, inside the core of the star, the particle was almost, you know, going in all possible directions. Very far outside the star, all the particles are going like this. So very few particles might, you know, get backscattered. So if I ask, at this point, what is the probability that you're going in any one given direction? Here, that probability will look something like this, that it is mostly in the forward direction and a little bit in the backward direction. Whereas here, it looks like this, equal in every direction. So what determines this position is the distance at which this neutrino stops interacting. So if, let's say, the cross section for neutrino interaction with whatever else that changes its direction, momentum changing collisions, is sigma, then the background density of x times sigma, this is n sigma, some relative velocity, but neutrinos are relativistic, so relative velocity is 1. This n sigma has units of n sigma v, let me just write for simplicity. N sigma v has units of 1 over time. Okay. Or if I don't put the v, n, so this is some 1 over time. n sigma assumes of 1 over length. This is the mean free path, right? So once the mean free path, so 1 over n sigma, 1 over n sigma, once it becomes larger, then the amount of material above this point. So suppose, you know, this is the core of the star. This is outward direction of the star. I am here and I count how much material is there above this. If my interaction probability above this point becomes less than one, you know, the optical depth, what is called, becomes less than one, then this is the point where I say that I stop interacting, that I become free stream. But this happens at different positions for the different neutrinos, because it depends on cross section, and the different neutrino flavors are different cross sections. So the new E decouples here, the new E bar here, and all the other neutrinos here. Okay? And so if I'm looking at some position like this, the new E still here has almost isotropic spectrum. But this has already decoupled here. It would have been isotropic here. If I drew it here, this would be isotropic here. Okay? But by the time I am here, its spectra looks more forward field. This is the reason for anisotropy. That looking at a particular distance just outside the decoupling of, let's say, the new E, makes the new E's very isotropic. But the other neutrinos have already become free streaming or forward peak much earlier. And this is the reason for the anisotropy in the distributions.
Sir, can you explain that shock delay effect again using that cartoon that you did initially?
What is it? Shock. See, what happens is this. There is a deep part of the star. There is a star. This is the core, star of core. Of course, everything is in the star. This is also the star, but there is a shock wave. Shock wave means what? Shock wave means that there is a density discontinuity or pressure discontinuity. That, and if I plot as a function of R, density is falling like this, then at the shock it increases like this, and then it falls again. This is rho. This is what a shock looks like. This is a shock. Okay, now neutrinos are being emitted from the innermost region from here, and this shock has lost all its energy. So, what has to happen? All these neutrinos must interact in this region. And that will heat up the shock from bottom and drive it forward. That is what neutrinos have to do. Is that the answer that you're looking for, or is the question a little different?
So that's what I was asking. Thank you.
Is there any other specific question? Please ask. Hannes, you want to ask anything interesting?
No, I have no further questions at the moment.
Avdesh? Do you have?
No, I don't have.
Okay.
I don't have questions.
And Shobhik, do you have anything specific? I have very, maybe not, you will laugh after listening this. So why always during the calculation people take this circular stars, means like you always take some radius R's, like spheric, not circular, maybe spherical.
We don't have to. So we have done problems where we don't have to take spherical symmetry. So here it is, not spherical. Okay, so of course, one can do complicated things which are not necessarily spherical.
Before explaining, just tell me why people do that. Means why people usually consider the spherical objects.
So that's what I'm saying. Correct. Sure. That's a very good question. The thing is that doing the calculation is much easier if you assume spherical.
Yeah, that's true. But
there is departure from spherical. Before.
Yeah.
And what we are trying to do is we are trying to ask, first of all, what is the zeroth order answer if, let's say, spherical symmetry were exact? Then you can calculate what are the departures from spherical symmetry going to give you. Okay. Now, it also is true that, especially after the first few hundred milliseconds, the star actually does become fairly spherical.
Okay.
Okay. The level of departure from spherical symmetry is not very large. Later in the evolution. But it is sufficiently large that the departures should be taken into account, and they are taken into account in detailed numerical calculations. But if you want analytical insight, if you want to understand what is going on in your complicated numerical simulation,
yeah, I can understand. Yeah.
You can make progress much more easily by first looking at the spherical symmetry.
But otherwise people can do whatever bit they want.
Yeah. So one thing is that, of course, even when you are, so let's say I am interested in computing the effects of turbulence in the star, which is what is going on here. Now, turbulence does not exist in spherical symmetry.
Yes.
Because in spherical symmetry, the only direction in which things can move are the radially outwards.
Yeah.
And then there's no turbulence, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you can still ask in some coarse grained sense that, okay, yes, I am going to assume that the heat flow is spherically symmetric. Particles are allowed to go and do whatever they want. So there is turbulence. But let me ask, what is the net outward heat flow due to turbulence? Okay, mm-hmm. So you can use spherical symmetry very cleverly at the level that you want to use it, without losing the important physics, which maybe even comes from things that are not spherically symmetric.
Okay, so you say that, right? If you go for some other objects, that will not give you some very, very interesting deviation compared to the...
It will. In many cases, it will. You have to be careful what you are doing. So, for example, in the case of neutron star mergers, spherical symmetry will be a terrible approximation. And there you should use something more similar to a cylindrical symmetry, because it's like a disk and everything is being emitted from a disk. So axis symmetry is a good approximation. Mm-hmm. Spherical symmetry is too strong. And there are papers we have also done work where we do that kind of thing. But I focused my talk today mostly on things which are a bit similar, because it was already quite technical and I don't want to make it more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that was my initial question, just I want to ask. And like, as you have told already that, even I also have seen that in your equations, you have taken care of the effect of the environment by considering that this is an open system. So like, how far people thought about this, because like I'm not very sure that people are very open about this kind of approach, like open quantum mechanics and all.
Well, I mean, see, these are big words, right? Let's just ask ourselves what we are trying to do. If we are trying to talk about a closed system, there's no problem. You know, we know how to do quantum mechanics.
Yes.
We are saying we have a quantum mechanics of some system coupled to some bar. Now, in general, this is a very hard problem, but we don't need the answer in general. Here, we are interested in a situation where the bath is a pure thermal bath. And in that case, in the specific context that we want to work in, the effects of the bath are taken into account through this matter effect terms, you know, this potential and everything that I wrote. So at least in this case, I know how to take into account the effect of the medium on my quantum system.
Yes.
It may not be possible to do that in general. For example, if there is some entanglement between my system and the system outside,
yes,
I will not be able to do that. In fact, the whole problem of collective oscillating physics was that I had to treat the neutrino with other neutrinos. That is what's going on in this equation. This part, yes, what it is doing is it is entangling the pure histories of the different density.
Mm-hmm.
That I have explicitly taken into account without making that part open.
Mm-hmm.
So this part has remained closed. What has remained open is interactions with things that are truly, you know, outside, like electrons in the back. So a clever choice of what you are taking as your system and what you exclude as your out of your system and, you know, keep it as part of the bath allows you to solve this so-called open quantum system.
Yes.
So in this case, basically we convert it to a closed system by just taking everything inside.
Yes. But
that is well.
But
of course, this is a much more complicated problem in general.
But as you have told just now, that if they are entangled, then you can't able to solve. Okay, so there is something called partial trace operation. If you do for the bath, and if you just do the partial trace of the bath, then you will get also the system properties. So in that case, you can't able to do.
I don't need it. In my problem, I have found a more clever and a more straightforward way.
Ah, okay.
Where I can just avoid doing all of that.
Okay. I can understand.
Because if you think about it, for me, the things that are entangled are the neutrinos. And I care about all the neutrinos. I want to know the answer for each neutrino. So if I traced out some of the neutrinos, then I would not know the information about them.
Okay, so you were saying that some of the information you may lose during this procedure.
You will lose the information about the part of the system that you are going to trace up.
Yes.
Right? But I really want to keep all the information about all the neutrinos, all the entangled state. I want to keep everything.
Okay.
So what I trace out is truly the stuff that is not entangled.
Yeah,
sir, but still, is the contribution of the second and the third term, are they like significantly high compared to the first one?
Yes, they are indeed. So you can, in some units, you will find that this first term is of the order of 0.3 kilometer inverse. Just use some of your units. This of the order of 10 to the 6.
Wow.
It is somewhere between 10 to the 7 to 10 to the 5.
Okay. That's pretty high.
And you are also very
careful. Because you see, this right density appears here. Sorry?
No, I'm saying that you are also very careful about writing the GF factor, G Fermi factor. Because of the dimensions and all.
Yes, I mean,
True. Yeah, it's incredible actually. I particularly haven't seen this kind of approach before, because I have seen neutrino oscillation is just like mostly people usually calculate in Schrodinger picture and all. But yeah, you gave a really nice interpretation. Any other
usually question? You can do that because you can work in the Schrodinger or the von Neumann picture without worrying about all these complicated things, because you never have to worry about two neutrinos affecting each other and you are trying to solve for the, you know, this is basically saying that you have many Schrodinger
get the motto of your problem, because you are actually handling a very complicated issue, which is never handled before. So that's why you get all these possible contributions, which are not actually redundant and significant.
No, but I think rather than think like that, I think the right way to think about the problem is the following. That each neutrino obeys a Schrodinger equation.
Yes.
There's no problem with that, which is what everyone does.
Mm-hmm.
But there are there's a tower of questions, one for each neutrino, which are coupled to each other.
Yes.
So this is in some sense a coupled, many body type of problem, where you have to, individually each of them is very easy. But once you couple everything, then it becomes a horrendous problem. And you have to find very clever ways to solve.
So that's why I'm saying that you have found out some good, clever way to how to solve this many body problem using analytic approximations. So that's the best part.
That is right.
Yeah.
That is the main analytical, let's say, advance of this work.
Yeah.
And then of course it has some phenomenological importance, which I told you.
Yeah. Sure. Thank you, and I'm hopefully you are very tired after giving this so long talk.
I can still go on for another hour, but I think you guys might be tired.
It's okay.
We might want to talk.
If you guys have any questions, those who are not here, I will post it in YouTube. And after listening this talk, if you have any specific question, please write to Basu in his email ID, and he can able to give you answers. And if you want to talk to him, he can talk. So please do that. And thank you, Basu. So thank you, Basu, for your contribution. This is the 56th contribution, as I have told. And we are very happy to have you in this forum. And we hopefully later also we can also ask you to give some more talks. This year already booked. Next year, in the new year, I will maybe invite you again. And with new ideas, you will talk about. Today you haven't talked about dark matter. Maybe you can talk about dark matter some other.
Well, I am giving. So actually, today morning I gave some pedagogical lectures on dark matter at this ICTS workshop.
Okay.
Again, tomorrow I am giving lectures.
Okay.
If the students are interested, of course, I think the lectures will be available.
Yeah, only one talk happened on dark matter by Stefano Profumo.
Mm-hmm.
So, people actually like dark matter. So, people ask me, there should be some more dark matter talk. You please ask people. So, maybe I will invite you, because I know that you gave a very good introduction. And so, I will invite you in proper time. So, thank you. Stay safe and healthy.
Thank you very much. Everybody who listens to your seminar series, and I know that there are many young students. You are very active in attracting a lot of students and working with them. And so, so one thing I will certainly tell to everybody who's listening is, look for lots of interesting things happening. There are many very interesting things happening. Online archives, many different ways. Please do get in touch with anyone and whoever you want to get in touch with. Do not feel afraid. Please feel free to write to me also.
Yeah.
And people will try to help. And get as much information as you can to take the best possible decisions. Towards making your research. Career go ahead. I think so. This is something that I will ask everyone, to feel free to get help from every possible
yes.
So we have a very open community, and
Yeah, like we actually ask everyone, like
this is good. Wherever you are as students.
Yeah, we don't have any prejudice to like only ask the high energy physics guys to give the talk. We ask the condensed matter people, maybe other people, because I want that people should explore everything and then decide what they do. Will.
So I would say specifically to the students that don't feel afraid of anyone and do not feel like you have to get stuck to one thing. So
yes.
You know, explore as much as possible. As students especially, I would strongly advise you.
Thank you, Vasu. So bye.
Okay. I think let's say good night. Thank you very much.